Tonight, we are pleased to host a discussion of affordable housing in Austin. And as many of y'all may know, we just celebrated the 50th anniversary of the Department of Housing and Urban Development, which my grandfather signed into law on September 9th, 1965. And on the 9th, we actually had our current HUD secretary, Julian Castro, join us to mark the occasion and talk about the housing issues that face the country. So tonight, we're talking about the housing issues as they face we face them in Austin. And at the end of the program, our guests are going to be available for Q&A. And then, as I said, we'll continue the conversation with food and drinks in there. So we hope y'all will stay around for that. We are so pleased to have y'all here. I'm going to introduce our moderator and let her take over. Sherri Greenberg here is our moderator. She is a lecturer and fellow of the Max Sherman Chair in State and Local Government at the LBJ School of Public Affairs. She is a good friend of the LBJ Library, the LBJ family, and the LBJ School of Public Affairs. We're very happy to have her. She served for 10 years as a member of the Texas House and is an expert on affordable housing herself. So thank you. Take it away, please.
All right. Thank you very much. Will do. So we are pleased to have a panel of experts with us here this evening on affordable housing. Mandy de Mayo has been a leader in the area of affordable housing and community development for more than 20 years. She currently serves as executive director of HousingWorks Austin. Mandy holds a master's degree in public affairs from the LBJ School of Public Affairs and is the author of a variety of policy papers on affordable housing in Austin. Michael Gerber is president and CEO of the Housing Authority of the City of Austin, known as HACA. He previously served as executive director at the Texas Department of Housing and Community Affairs. He has also served in the Office of Public and Indian Housing for the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. And he was responsible for providing strategy and management advice to the secretary there. He's also served as an advisor to Governor Rick Perry and U.S. Senators Phil Graham and Kay Bailey Hutchison. Parisa Fatehi-Weeks is Google Fiber's Community Impact Manager in Austin. And I also have to add that she is a graduate of the LBJ School of Public Affairs, where she holds a master's. She's one of my students. Yes, I am old. And she also has a law degree from the University of Texas at Austin. And we are delighted to have her here with us. She grew up in Austin, and she has served in a variety of capacities with the city manager's office here, as an advocate for civil rights in San Francisco, and of course, now with Google Fiber here. So each of our esteemed panelists here have been given 5 and only 5 minutes to give us a very quick take on what they see as affordable housing from their vantage point here in Austin. Then I'll have some questions and we will open it up to audience Q&A. Take it away, Mandy.
Okay.
Yes, absolutely.
So I work for a small nonprofit, HousingWorks Austin, which some of you may be familiar with. We were created in 2006. We are an affordable housing research, education, advocacy organization. And I've been with them really for about the last 5 years as executive director the last 2 years. Affordable housing is an increasing problem in the city of Austin. I moved here in 1991 to go to the LBJ School. For public policy, and it was a whole different world then. Austin was, at the time, it was the most expensive rental market in the state of Texas, and having moved from Washington, D.C., I couldn't believe how cheap it was. It was incredible. I think I rented I was in a two-bedroom apartment and paid $400 a month, I mean, for the entire two-bedroom apartment. And those days, of course, are long, long gone. We were created in 2006 around the affordable housing bonds. Some of you may recall that that was the first time in the state of Texas, certainly, but in the city of Austin, that we voters overwhelmingly approved general obligation bonds dedicated to affordable housing. And the reason that was so important was typically general obligation bonds are used for infrastructure. And when we think of infrastructure as a community, we think of roads, and we think of parks and libraries, but we feel very strongly in the affordable housing community that affordable housing is part of our infrastructure. We cannot function as a society if we do not have housing stock that serves the people who live in our community. So we were thrilled in 2006 when voters approved $55 million in affordable housing bonds. Those dollars were all wisely spent and invested in a variety of projects that I'm happy to talk about, but I can't fit into my five minutes. But we created more than 3,400 units of affordable housing, and it was great. And now we are on our second round of affordable housing bonds. $65 million that we're currently in the process of investing. So we were involved in that process, but we were created because we realized that we needed more than just housing bonds. We needed more than just financing. We needed policies that really supported affordability throughout the city of Austin. So we brought a group of folks together that included really the spectrum of from affordable housing advocates to business leaders to faith leaders to house private developers who do market rate housing. We brought them all together and with the goal of sitting around the table, a broad table, and hammering out really workable policy solutions to affordable housing. And so that's been our mission over the last nine years. And we've had a lot of great advances, but we have a lot more work to do, and I think we'll be getting into some of that.
Yes,
I don't know if
we
my
will.
5 minutes is ticking down. I talked as fast as I could, but we've had a lot on our plate recently.
You have a couple growing minutes to go.
Oh, I do. Okay. Growing challenges, and really the biggest challenge, population growth. Anybody who lives in Austin knows that, you know, that is just a fact of life. Historically, we double in size every 20 years. That's projected to continue into the future. We have our Imagine Austin comprehensive plan that looks to kind of deal with that population growth and really envisions this idea of not just compact and connected community, but this idea of complete communities where we do have all types of housing in all parts of town, which I think is critical and will help to address housing, transportation, jobs, all of those things that are intricately related. So in terms of challenges, I would say the biggest challenge we have is if you look at a regular old graph of income and housing costs, our incomes are flat and our housing costs are increasing exorbitantly. Whether you're a renter or an owner, it is a challenge for most people across the income spectrum, but it is a particular challenge for very low-income people, including people who are living on fixed incomes, like seniors and people with disabilities. So we hope that we can implement, and that is our goal, to implement policies that really increase affordability across that spectrum from very low income people living on fixed income up to first time home buyers, folks in the middle income.
Thank you, Mandy. Michael?
Thanks. Good evening, everybody. Let me give a quick shout out first to both Mandy and to Sherri. Both are providing incredible thought leadership on affordable housing in our community. The work of HousingWorks is really critical, I think, to that effort. I'm proud to serve on the board of HousingWorks. And one of the things that that I have found just remarkable really about the last 9 months is that we have a new mayor who is really focusing very intently on issues of affordable housing. And I just say, I mean, the progress that's been made about really confronting issues of inequality and affordability in our city, we've made more progress in dealing head-on with some of those issues in the last 9 months than we have in the last nine mayor's terms. It's really been extraordinary. So I anchor my organization, the Housing Authority of the City of Austin, which is a unit of local government, really anchors one side of the housing spectrum. If you think of housing from homelessness to homeownership, we're far closer to the homeless piece. We really are and do form the housing social safety net for the city. Housing authorities, for those of you who don't know much about them, there's actually about 3,500 of them across the country, and we receive most of our funding directly from the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. And most of the money that we receive goes really into two pots. One is to actually operate public housing units, fixed assets, apartment complexes here in the city of Austin, and then also for Section 8, now known as the Housing Choice Voucher Program. So I want to talk a little bit about both of those pots. First, though, I should probably give you a little history about HACA. HACA takes great pride that we're the first housing authority in the United States. We take that pride, especially when we go to other cities and they claim to be the first housing authority. No. And so the story goes that Lyndon Johnson, as a young congressman, was very critical to the effort to get the 1937 Housing Act passed. And in that, as that bill was working its way through Congress, at the end, three housing authorities were created, New York, New Orleans, and Austin. And then Congressman Johnson ensured that Austin was, that he wanted them put in alphabetical order so that Austin could forever brag that we were the first created housing authority in the United States. And we take that designation very, very seriously. We also take great pride that the oldest public housing property, Santa Rita Courts, is here in Austin, and the first three properties that were financed by then the U.S. Housing Administration are here in Austin, Santa Rita Courts, Rosewood Courts, and Chalmers Courts. And as a sign of the time of segregation, Santa Rita was devoted to was dedicated to Hispanic persons, Chalmers for whites, and Rosewood for African Americans. Thank goodness those days are gone, and our properties are obviously integrated, and are just this incredible tapestry of folks that really are at the very lowest income in our community. So we operate 18 public housing properties, and as you might expect, sadly, they're in that crescent of poverty that exists kind of from North Lamar, around the eastern part of the city, and then down to about South Lamar. That's where we have our 18 properties. And they vary in size. We have a high-rise building that's right next door to, right behind the Four Seasons Hotel, right there on Town Lake, that's dedicated to seniors and persons with disabilities. That's our largest high-rise building. And then we have properties that look very much residential. One down south called Bolden Oaks is really a nice community of duplexes. And if you get the sense that it's a planned community, certainly, but you don't get the impression that it's public housing. So there's really a broad mix. We have 1,838 units of public housing, and that serves about 4,500 people. On the Section 8 side, we serve about 14,500 people. So on any given night here in Austin, we're serving about 19,000 folks. And so we're really proud that we're able to provide those services, and we're the largest housing social safety provider here in Central Texas. I would just tell you just a little bit about who we serve. We serve, out of those 19,000 people, roughly 5,000 of them are persons with disabilities, nearly 3,000 of them are elderly persons, almost 10,000 of them are kids. So it's an extraordinary amount of kids, and I always am amazed when people say, your folks just don't want to work. We always hear the pick yourself up by your bootstraps and people need to go to work. And we agree that there are people who should pick themselves up and should take positive steps through job training programs and other programs to achieve self-sufficiency. I'll come back and talk about that in just a second. But we'll talk about it later. But we're very much dedicated to self-sufficiency, but I'm always interested in that because, who exactly is it that you wanted to work? Did you want the 10,000 kids to work? Did you want the seniors to work? Did you want the persons with disabilities who struggle with profound disabilities? Do you expect them to work? And so we'll talk a little bit more, I think, this evening about who comprises public housing and some of the services that we offer.
Yes, thanks. We will. Parisa?
So thanks for having me. Like Sherri said, I'm Parisa Fatehi-Weeks, and though I have a past life as serving as a civil rights attorney working on affordable housing and access to public transit issues, that's not why I'm here. It's not what I've done in Austin. Really, the reason I'm here is really a testament to partners like the Housing Authority of the City of Austin and a partnership that Google Fiber has gotten to strike through folks like Catherine and Mike kicking off a digital inclusion initiative at the Housing Authority that I'll tell you at the very end of my remarks. But if you'll indulge me for a second, I wanted to just say a little bit about my background personally, which is when I moved to the United States with my family when I was 5 months old, we came straight to Austin and we lived in housing subsidized by the University of Texas at Austin. And though the red bricks that you would see on the outside looked very modest, it was actually very rich because we had access to the top-notch public transit, frequently running buses to the university. We had access to strong community. We had access to all the resources of the university system. So I spent probably as much time at university libraries as a child as I did when I went to school here. And it made all the difference for a family that was learning English, didn't have a car, and was in a new country for the first time. And I think that's what you talk about when you say complete communities. It's what we talk about when we say opportunity-rich communities. And that is exactly what I had the privilege to come to when I moved to the United States as a five-month-old. And it is those things that I mentioned that are those key building blocks to opportunity, that access to the bus system, huge. It's one of those key building blocks, the libraries. And today, access to the internet, it turns out, is one of those building blocks that's key. We know that 80% of Fortune 500 companies require you to apply online and online only. So if you want to work at Walmart, if you want to work at Target, you've got to submit an application online. Well, if you don't have access at home, you're going to have to jump on a bus. Hopefully you know when to catch that bus. Then you go and you hope to get a spot at the public library's computer lab. You might only have 30-minute slot to work in that computer lab before it's someone else's turn. So by the time you do that initial research to even see what jobs are out there, you've run out of time to put your resume together and submit the application online. So huge, huge barriers right there. We know that teachers report that 80% of them assign homework that you have to get online to complete. Mm-hmm. So all of these really paint the picture of why the internet and access to it at home is just as essential a building block as we now know housing and public transit to be. And it's for that reason that Google Fiber has had the privilege of partnering with the Housing Authority and others in the community to they lead this initiative called the Unlocking the Connection Initiative. And through this initiative, if you're a public housing resident, you will get access to the internet in your home, in your unit, at no cost. You'll also get the chance to sign up for some form of computer training, digital literacy training, we call it. And then third, if you complete a substantial portion of that training, you will then earn a refurbished computer device thanks to a donation from the Austin Community College System that refreshes their inventory every so often. So through this program, the Housing Authority has designed something that really addresses all three of the major barriers we know folks face when they're trying to cross over to the other side of the digital divide. And that's one, affordability of the connection itself. So Google Fiber's coming in on that. The education and the sense of relevance. It turns out a lot of folks have no sense that internet today is essential to improving your quality of life. So these classes really make that case, but then also show you how to touch a mouse for the first time. Some people are scared by the keyboard, the mouse, turning it on. And then third, of course, getting folks access to that device in their home. So really lucky to be a part of that partnership because I think it's part of what is going to make housing a more complete and opportunity-rich place.
Thank you very much, and thank all of you for your very insightful comments. And if I were to put a frame around this, I think that I would speak of equitable access to quality of life, right? And what are the components here in Austin to have that equitable access to quality of life? We speak of complete communities. Well, if you don't have a place to live, it's hard to go to school or workforce training. You need transit. You need all of these components. But we know that there is a segment of our population, unfortunately, that's growing despite the fact that we're booming. Not everyone is sharing in that prosperity. Or we have a situation where, as you said, Mandy, wages are flat, but prices are increasing dramatically for rents and for buying homes. So the question is, how do we address this housing affordability issue? I think, and all of you came at that from different points from the access. Mandy, I will start with you, and that is, if there were one or two policies, because you mentioned that you do policy at HousingWorks, if there were one or two policies, whatever, that we could change that you think would start to move the needle, what would they be?
Oh, it's so hard to narrow it down to one or two.
Well, okay, but, whatever.
I could go on and on.
Not on and on.
I know. But, you know, equity really resonates with me because I think that's the challenge that we're facing now. Mike mentioned the crescent of poverty. And
right, the eastern crescent.
The eastern, you know, that goes from north to east and then around south. And if I could change one thing, first we need to get our arms around the problem. We need to really understand what the problem is. And we just released city council district analysis, looking right at all 10 city council districts and what their housing challenges and opportunities are, going from homelessness all the way up to home ownership. So looking at the number of unsheltered homeless people in each district, the poverty rate in each district, the number of subsidized housing units, and then also access to transit. We looked at a whole variety of different indicators. And the thing that really struck me was when we lined up all 10 city council districts, we realized that the council districts that are primarily east of I-35, so districts 1, 2, and 3, contained 48% of the subsidized housing, not just the housing authority units. This is all of our subsidized housing stock. We have about 18,500
So including tax
units.
Credits and other...
Tax credits, and we have some programs, housing for people with disabilities, housing,
right.
Some federal programs, housing for the elderly, anything that's subsidized in some way or another, either local, state, or federal.
But you didn't include in that market rate affordable.
We did not include market rate affordable. So 18,500 is the universe we're playing with, and we put them all on a map. You can see all the dots. So east of I-35, they have about half of the units. And then once you got west of MOPAC, which are primarily districts 6, 8, and 10 are primarily west of MOPAC, they contain 3% of the subsidized housing units. So I look at that, again, getting back to my initial comments about housing as infrastructure. To me, it's not just an equity issue, it's also an issue of we have low and moderate wage jobs all over the city. Mm-hmm. There are lots of jobs that we have mapped out in District 6, 8, and 10. And because we are not providing those affordable housing opportunities, we are cutting people off from opportunity. Mm-hmm. We're also exacerbating our transportation problems. Ask anyone right. what the top three issues are in the city of Austin. Well, it's congestion, transportation, housing, and water.
So you really getting at some of that suburbanization of poverty where people are moving further out because that's the only place they can afford to live, but the jobs aren't there.
Driving and the jobs aren't there and the public transportation is not
yes,
there.
So some of them cannot work, or if they can, they're contributing right. to traffic.
Right. So in terms of changing policies, I think we're moving in that direction. One quick thing would be aligning all of our housing, transportation, and economic development policies. I think that's critical. We can't just place affordable housing over here. Likewise, we can't just place transportation over here or jobs over here without thinking the interrelation between all three.
So the nexus of housing, jobs, and transit?
It's there.
Right.
And we need to recognize it, and we need to channel our funding that way, and we need to align our policies that way. That would be one policy. The other policy, never mind more funding. I mean, that's critical,
yes.
and we need that. But another policy would be really looking at our non-funding resources, so non-fiscal resources like publicly owned land. We have an incredible array of public entities, including the county and the city and Cap Metro and Austin Energy and the state of Texas
and district.
University of Texas, AISD, who may be cash poor, but they do have resources in terms of public underutilized land. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to all get together and look at what are those underutilized resources and where does it make the most sense to actually invest in affordability. Because land is one of the most expensive when you're building a construction project, depending on the location.
Absolutely.
Land is a huge part of the budget.
Absolutely. Thank you, Mandy. So, Michael, I know that HACA has some very innovative programs. It's not your grandparents' housing authority. And I was hoping that you could tell us about some of those.
Sure, glad to. I can't resist adding a third one. The rewrite.
Go for it.
The rewrite of the land
development.
Code.
Yes.
Oh my gosh,
the land use code.
So critical.
Yes.
How could I forget that? I'm on the advisory group.
Maybe that's why you forgot it.
Development in this city is more expensive right. than anywhere else in the state of Texas, and it takes longer to get housing on the ground. And the result is that those costs get borne by the developer get passed along, and they can't afford to develop affordable units. Because of those costs, because of those delays, because of that uncertainty, the risk factor is just becomes preventative.
Well, that gets into the permitting process,
too. The
zoning and the permitting, I think you're alluding to both of those.
Yes, absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So I would add that. With respect to HACA, there are some really creative things that we're doing. Obviously, unlocking the connection is one of the newest and coolest things that we're doing. But for many years, we've really sort of changed from being just a housing authority that provides housing. It's really also about where people are able to move them to self-sufficiency. So it's meant really an incredible array of really rich partnerships focused really around three areas, education, healthcare, and job training. And you name it, we have a partnership with them. I'll give you an example in the realm of job training. We work extensively with the Workforce Solutions Board. We work with SkillPoint Alliance. We work with Goodwill. We work with Capital Idea, all with the intention of trying to come up with a customized solution for folks who live in our properties. The reality is that many of the folks who live in our properties have never had someone rooting for them, have never had coaching, have never had mentoring. And providing that casework piece really becomes critical. And we have a team of social workers and caseworkers who really track progress and try to encourage them through a variety of programs that we operate internal to HACA, one called the Family Self-Sufficiency Program, the other called the Resident Opportunity for Self-Sufficiency Program. Those are also HUD-funded projects, but the idea is that we provide some basic support, get people out into the community, working with nonprofits and other agencies that really have the skills and capability to train folks, not just with the intent of training them in something, but training them with the intent of getting them a job, and where there's really going to be a job at the end of their program. We do the same in education and in healthcare as well. But I wanted to tie it to what Parisa was talking about, unlocking the connection. You know, it's great to give people a device. It's great to give people the opportunity to have a free internet connection for 10 years at no charge. That's important to us because we, for lots of reasons. But if folks only use it for accessing Facebook and for video games, the whole thing was a waste. The goal is to see better outcomes in healthcare and job training and education.
So not just technology as a shiny new toy, but actually with a purpose behind it.
Exactly, and giving them devices that are relevant for them. So if there's kids in the household, we want to give them tablets. If there's you know, for seniors, it may be a desktop. For others, it may be to start. Some may have the aspiration to start a new business, and give them the tools to be able to operate QuickBooks or other types of things. That's why the partnership with ACC, with Austin Freenet, with so many others to handle the digital literacy piece is really key. And then being able to make midterm corrections as we roll this thing out, because we really are rolling this out somewhat slowly because we want to evaluate its progress, and some of it's also dictated by how fast Google Fiber is also rolling out. So we're starting south, working our way east, and then we'll wind up north and finish out our properties. But we're also studying it. There's two professors here at the University of Texas who are doing a longitudinal study, and they'll give us some early reads on our success and are we seeing those outcomes. And so we'll have the ability to make mid-course corrections if we need to. One other thing I'd mention, separate from the programming that we have, we also operate a subsidiary called Austin Affordable Housing Corporation. I'm sorry? Yes, they should. But we basically operate right now about 1,600 off units that are have no subsidy attached to them, right, but they're fully open to Section 8 residents.
So they're private market, but Section 8 take the vouchers, right?
Correct. And there's really a shortage of yes, landlords who will take Section 8. And our goal by acquiring the property is that we try to keep the rents between 20% and 30%. Below the market. So in a lot of cases, we're really sort of the last vestige of a neighborhood's affordability. And we're really proud of that. We also do some other things by way of tax credits and trying to develop some of our own properties. Those do come with subsidies and lots of rules attached to them. And can talk a little bit about that more.
So Parisa, you certainly made a compelling case from your own history and the work you're doing now about access. And we've talked about access in several areas, and certainly with digital, again, it's not in this respect, we're not talking about a shiny new toy, we're talking about a way for people to have access and to improve their lives. And I know that's what you're doing with Rosewood, but I'm wondering, does Google have other projects of this type in mind that would help with access, that would help with those who don't have the digital technology they need either to do their homework or to put that resume together to get a job or other facets of their lives?
Yeah, so that's the issue I have the privilege of working on across Austin with other partners in addition to the Housing Authority. So the Housing Authority example is a really robust program. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I left out the fact it is such a model that President Obama and Secretary Castro announced this summer that they want to do this in 28 other communities across the country. And it's really modeled on what HACA's done, and they've been named as the mentor city, right, to these other 28 communities across the country to do an initiative just like this one that's multi-pronged and looks at all these barriers to getting online. So we actually have an entire priority in our work to advance social good in Austin. Is our top priority is what we call digital inclusion, which is another way of saying how can we narrow the digital divide. And there are a lot of nonprofits, a lot of community-based organizations in Austin doing really wonderful work on this issue. You heard Austin Freenet, one of the longest standing in the country, that's been doing digital literacy work, teaching people wherever it is their starting point is. For some folks, it's not knowing how to turn the device on. For some folks, they do know how to do that. Maybe they know how to use the technology for one purpose, but have no idea how to use it for professional development, to start a resume, to start an email address for the first time. So we certainly support financially and in other ways groups like Austin Freenet, groups like River City Youth Foundation, another really national model in how to build the digital literacy of an entire family. They operate out of Dove Springs, and they do so in a way that is really tailored to the culture and language of that rich community that has such a history and is ready to get into the technological world, but really needs some of those classes and resources.
So I know all of us are very passionate about this topic, and we've covered really a lot of territory so far, talking about equitable access to quality of life and how here we're that's starting with having a roof over your head, a place to live, and the nexus of that with transit and with workforce. And there are lots of other programs we could discuss and policy tools. The city perhaps making changes to beyond the zoning with Code Next and the permitting, the density bonus program and the smart housing program and some of these other tools. Certainly, many of us are looking for innovative financing in this realm, but really there's two parts of the equation, as we've discussed. One is the supply of housing that's affordable from people who are at the very lowest, 30% of median family income, all the way through workforce housing and up to 120% of median family income. And the other is increasing people's ability to afford with the workforce. And somewhere in there is the transit to get them back and forth. So I thank you for these comments. What I'd like to do now is open up to questions from our audience here, and I am sure you have some. So, yes. Sure. So you bring up a really big question, and just, I think it was this morning, I was listening to something on the radio, and I believe they were referring to a program in San Francisco where subsidized housing had, in this particular area, managed to maintain some diversity and the character of the neighborhood because you had that subsidized housing, and without it, you would not have. So clearly, there is a role for subsidized housing and maintaining that neighborhood culture, rich culture, and diversity. But we cannot escape the fact that the African American population here is decreased, the only city of its kind in the country where we're seeing that. And we know that there are other issues with affordability that I think you're alluding to. How would you address those?
Well, it's interesting because I think the article you're referring to, it was the executive director of the Tenderloin CDC,
which is
a neighborhood in San Francisco.
That was exactly it.
And what he said is, I view our affordable housing as an inoculation against gentrification.
That was right.
And what he said, which this is an interesting flip to
it
what
is.
I had said earlier about, districts 1, 2, and 3 having the bulk of the subsidized housing stock. The guy from the Tenderloin district neighborhood in San Francisco said, because we have, I think they have about a third of the housing stock is actually subsidized, and so it's required to be affordable for a certain period of time, and there's monitoring and compliance. Because of that, he said, I don't really care what the market does. That's great. We've got a third of the housing stock that is not going to change. So he was, you know, viewing mm-hmm. that positively in terms right. of an inoculation against gentrification. But without a doubt, we've got huge gentrification issues, and it's not just, I was talking to somebody today who was saying, you know, it's not just on the east side. No. People are getting pushed out all over the city. We talked about the suburbanization of poverty. The poverty rate actually declined in the city of Austin between last year and this year, and Ryan Robinson, our demographer, said, don't pat yourselves on the back. It's not that we got richer. It's just that we're pushing them to Bastrop and, you know, Fayette mm-hmm. County and wherever. A couple of things that I think are really important policies. One, I will go back to the affordable housing bonds, and one of the great things about the housing bonds is they support a program, the Austin Housing Repair Coalition, which mm-hmm. is a coalition of five nonprofits that actually go out and do home repairs for low-income senior, primarily seniors, homeowners. And most of them have been Central East Austin that fit in that category. And for an average of, it was about $7,000, $7,500, it's primarily fixing leaky windows, accessibility modifications, really health and safety issues. They're enabling seniors who are long time, these are mostly generational mm-hmm. Homeowners, Central East, enabling them to stay. But the reality is we need more of that, and again, that takes resources. Right now, I think that the budget for the Housing Repair Coalition is about $2 million a mm-hmm. year. We could certainly use more. The other thing I will say is we're finally about to get on the books something called the Homestead Preservation District, which was initially passed by state legislation but never implemented. This was mm-hmm. in 2005, so it only takes us about a decade. And that is the first district, District A. We've subsequently identified more districts that fit the criteria for, it was basically a way to combat gentrification, to provide additional resources for some of these areas that have high poverty rates, that are higher disproportionate to the city, and to provide some additional resources to enable people to live in their own homes and to provide additional funding for housing in that neighborhood. So the district that we are about to, right. to put into action, essentially, will enable, it'll implement a TIF, tax increment financing district in Central East Austin that will ultimately generate funds that'll be exclusively for that district, for affordable housing in that district, and also provide the possibility for some abatement, tax abatement for both homeowners and property owners, provided they improve their properties to keep their taxes low. All right. So that was a lot, but.
Yes, sir.
My name is Dwayne White. I'm affiliated with Southwest Keys Nonprofit Organization, and our program is Neighbors United for Progress. We've had one affordable housing meeting, but Dr. McGee was one of the panels on there. And what I found out through like 55, 60 of the single parents in our complex, which is Fort Branch, that they're struggling. Some of them have real jobs, like, you know, secretaries or nurses, mm-hmm. and they find it hard just to get a home. Mm-hmm. Because that level is like $75,000 per house. So I'm asking the question, how is that going to help?
Michael?
Single mothers.
I'm not sure. I don't know the specific program or the housing. Without a doubt, when we talked about earlier about people struggling, it is not, our homeless numbers are actually going down. Right. We're doing a great job, primarily through Permanent Supportive Housing Initiative, which is great. We've seen over the last 3 years our homeless numbers going up, down. But what we are seeing is...
the workforce issues.
Workforce issues.
Right.
Struggles with rent and home ownership. Our comprehensive housing market study, which was released last summer, and the data is still good.
It's the summer of 2014, right?
Yeah, yes. 2014.
Fort Branch is going through like four managers, four people have bought this complex, mm-hmm. and they're going up every time. So mm-hmm. the people that's on disability, they're right. pushing them out into the homeless.
Exactly, and we're mm-hmm. seeing that really mm-hmm. across the city. Which is, what I was gonna say is we've got about 48,000, we need about 48,000 units that are affordable. That's primarily to people making $25,000 a year and less. That's workforce. Those are people who are, those are, you know, childcare workers, service right. workers, that whole, you know, critical industry. And then also, I think you had mentioned home ownership, the enormous need for housing in the $200,000 range, which would be affordable to somebody who's earning between 60 and 80% of median family income.
Which for a family of four is what, about $46,000 at 60% of median family income?
So those are nurses and teachers, and you know, you're getting into kind of that income category. So huge, huge.
So I want to be able to take some additional questions. Yes, ma'am.
We're very excited about them and very high on them. The city has one as well, but we are operating something called a community land trust, where we're trying to effectively land bank and bet that the appreciation in property, that there's a creative way to
Do you want to talk about how those work, a community land trust?
You know, essentially, you purchase a property. I'll give you an example. We've purchased one at it's called Bentry Apartments. It's right off of Mopac and Steck on the west side of Mopac. And it's 128 units and has a wonderful group of residents who've been there for quite some time. We got a great deal on that property. We've been able to, we're going to hold on to that for quite some time. And the intent is, over time, we believe between the appreciation that we get, one day we may sell it with the intent of maybe being able to buy double that 128 units somewhere else. Or we may choose to redevelop it, which would keep more affordable housing in West Austin. But we're sort of betting on the appreciation that happens over time. On the homeownership front, I'll give you an example. For this gentleman who's talking about homeownership opportunities in East Austin, some of you may have heard about our efforts to redevelop a property called Rosewood Courts. And one of the components of that is that we heard a lot from the community about there not being any affordable homeownership. We're proposing to develop 25 homeownership units at that property. We would enter into a shared equity, we'd land bank them, so we would retain ownership of the land. It would be home ownership, but it wouldn't be able to be transferred to you know their children or to someone else. They'd have to be a qualified resident who goes to live there, hopefully a public housing resident or the next possible level.
You maintain the affordability by owning the land.
Correct.
You can separate the land from the unit.
Correct.
Right?
And over time, as the family lives there, when the property sells, we will then go and we'll share the equity.
But you will still own the land.
We'll
continue, the unit sells.
We'll continue to own the land.
Right.
The homeowner will get a portion of that equity. We'll retain that equity, and it'll help us to pay to basically buy down the cost of it and retain the affordability over time. And we pass it down to the next person in need and keep it as a fixed asset for us to use.
They do a similar model in Miller-Mueller.
At the City of Austin has several.
And the City of Austin has one. Also, Guadalupe Neighborhood Development Corporation on the east side also operates a community land trust and has a fabulous new subdivision that's coming online. Similar model, just the land is owned by the nonprofit and the improvement is owned by the family who is qualified, who is income qualified. Typically, it's at or below 80% median family.
I think this community is looking to do more of these community land trusts.
And I would just say, I think that's a big theme of the ability to, as the state, as governmental entities, the University of Texas and such, you know, have excess property, putting them into a community land trust helps us all.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and co-locating that by schools and jobs, given where some of that property is. Additional questions? Yes, sir.
I think that's interesting. It was formerly publicly owned. It was owned by Texas Department of Transportation. And the city did make an attempt to purchase the property. So I would use that as an example of city policy that we need to change and we're working on, because there are going to be lots of other opportunities, several in West Austin, including the Austin State Supported Living Center, which my understanding is on the southwest corner of 35th and Mopac.
Right.
that provides an opportunity because the city, due to state legislation, has essentially the right of first refusal when that comes up for sale, which my understanding is it should be sometime around 2017.
And I think this points out, Mandy, the need, too, for additional financing and something that the mayor and members of the community and the city council committee and others and staff are working on together is to put together a fund that would have money that is outside of what we have now, not public resources. We've done wonderful job with those general obligation bonds. It's been able, we've been able to do twice the amount of housing, but to look to other sources, whether it's private sector or foundations and whatnot, to to come up with an additional funding source so that if this land becomes available, additional land, for instance, from the state, we're in a position as a community to be able to purchase that land.
To acquire it and then entitle it, which is essentially what happened with Miller Mueller. The city was able to entitle it and then require the 25% affordability, which is a win-win for the community. And we'd like to see that in future opportunities, particularly opportunities in West Austin or high opportunity areas. It doesn't have to be West Austin, but any area with access to transportation, jobs, good schools,
all of those things. So I think we probably have time for just a couple more questions. I see a hand back there, a gentleman in the back. Yes?
Thank you. Stand up. Some of the opportunities you mentioned earlier, will that help in West Austin and Clarksville? I've lived there since 1988. Taxes now can barely support living there, and we continue to see all the houses be developed. But I saw something for the first time just a couple of months or so ago. After the tragedy that happened in Charleston, several of us went into the neighborhood to Sunday church at Sweet Home Baptist, which was wonderful. Kicked myself for not doing it before, but you saw how few families were there. And that's a community. That's a sense of spirit that when that's gone, we lose so much more than the next high riser that comes in. So the question is, in these areas like Clarksville and others, what's being done so people can stay there, so we can maintain rich communities?
I think, and I know Mandy will elaborate on this, but when we talk about Code Next and we talk about changes in zoning and maybe something along the lines of what we used to call granny flats, but accessory dwelling units, some of those might hold possibility.
To enable some more affordable opportunities and, you know, kind of
in established
core
neighborhoods in the urban core.
But I would also say we're incredibly fortunate to have a handful, we need more, but a handful of community development corporations that were created in the 1980s, and Clarksville is one is one of them.
That's right.
You know, as the mayor, I've heard the mayor say multiple times, you know, we just have an issue, we have great solutions, we have an issue of scale. So we have Clarksville Community Development Corporation. I mentioned before Guadalupe Community Neighborhood Development Corporation. Similar, they're nonprofits, community-based nonprofits, the board of directors is people living in the community, and they have acquired housing, they own housing, they manage housing in the community. Guadalupe has scaled up. You know, they're central East Austin. They own and manage a 24-unit apartment complex. They also have a for-sale program and then own a bunch of rental housing. My understanding is Clarksville Community Development Corporation was a little bit dormant for a while. I think they have a handful of properties in Clarksville that they rent to qualified, income-qualified folks. But I know that they have another development, hopefully a duplex, on their radar screen. And so we're hoping to see more affordable, again, subsidized. So it is there's long-term affordability attached to it so that people who live in the neighborhood can stay in the neighborhood.
So I think we have time for one final short question. I'll take one right here. Final short question.
Final short question. Okay, another challenge that the city has is landlords not accepting vouchers. The state shot down the source of income classification protection that the city passed recently during this past session. So what kind of ideas do you think we can use to approach that problem now that the one that we tried to use is a no-go?
Right. So the city had passed an ordinance, and there was legislation that basically made that ordinance null and void, talking about vouchers. And there's also been a Supreme Court decision stemming from Dallas about tax credits and having housing not concentrated in certain areas. So we'll roll all of that up together. What do you think? Go for it, Michael.
Fortunately or unfortunately, my name was on that lawsuit involving the said Dallas when I headed up the Texas Department of Housing.
I happen to know that.
and you know the embarrassing thing about it, or maybe the wonderful thing about it, is that looking back, you know, those of us who have been involved in public policy never like to think that the thing we did had that kind of result. And the issue was the way the state awarded tax credits, unreasonably concentrating the allocation of those credits in poor areas of communities around Texas. And could a particular approach to analyzing it, looking at disparate impact, could that be used under the Fair Housing Act? And the Supreme Court said it could. And as I've dealt with issues of inequality here in our city, where we're so far from the progress that you would have thought we would have made since Lyndon Johnson delivered the violet on the tarnished, the tarnished on the violet crown speech. We're the most segregated city in the state, arguably the most segregated city in the United States. I heard a pastor from East Austin who shared that, you know, it's not bad enough to have you know, East Drive or East Street. You know, now, you know, he's come to almost hate I-35. Of course, we all hate I-35, but it serves as a very physical barrier to poverty issues and really is in a lot of ways a racial divide.
The great divide.
All that said, I think it's a shame that the state legislature went and overturned what this city chose to prioritize. We said as a community value that if someone's having their rent paid for, that they should be able to go and have any landlord in the city be required to accept that rental voucher. And the state legislature said that the interests of the landlord overrode the interests of the renter, and that it wasn't legal to do so. The result is that I believe it's not going to be settled until it's taken to court, and until those who receive rental assistance truly are able to, in some means, in either state law or some other form, enshrine that. Doesn't matter where your rent comes from. If it comes from a state program, a federal program, that's a legitimate means of having your rent covered. And that truly, as Mandy said, you know, we really do aspire to, as a community, I think, to the value of all types of housing for all types of people in all parts of town. If you look at where Section 8 housing is today, it is heavily concentrated in that crescent of poverty. It's a map that makes me miserable every time I see it, because we're not putting people in areas of high opportunity, and we know exactly where those areas of high opportunity are, and those are the communities that raise the biggest fuss, in many respects, on the source of income issue, which was very, very, folks who came from some of those communities, and it was very, very disappointing to see that. This is a case where really, civil rights attorneys and fair housing attorneys have contributed immeasurably to protecting the rights and interests and promoting opportunity through these programs. And I think, unfortunately, because of some of the things that we're seeing in the state legislature on this issue, we're going to need to continue to do more. I want to just interject one last thing, which is just sort of the scope of the problem. Because I don't want anyone to think that this is a 5,000-person problem or a 10,000-person problem. When Mandy talked about the first housing bonds that were passed for $55 million in 2006, the number of affordable housing units that were estimated to be needed to be built were 39,000. Mm-hmm. Go to when we went with the bonds back in, oh, sorry, no, it was 39,000 in
39,000 in 2009,
right.
And we did another housing study.
And then sometime later, 2014.
5 years later.
It became 49,000. Shortly afterwards, when that first bond failed to pass, but then came back 9 months later, it had gone up to 55,000. Some folks in the community have suggested that the real number is much higher than that. There's a need over the next 10 years to develop as many as 100,000 units of affordable housing.
Well, that's, I would say, housing in general.
Yeah, housing in general.
What I would say is that there's an issue of scale, and that you can look at the different levels. You could look to needing 48,000 of subsidized across different income levels, and that is a huge issue. Mm-hmm. And then you add to that another maybe 20,000 in the 80 to 121 Right, and so the numbers are large. So I think that our time has come to an end, but we have talked about challenges, and certainly we have a challenge as far as the amount of affordable housing, and some of the changes that we would like to see. But I also think that we have opportunities. We have opportunities in this community with so many people willing to work together for household affordability, on affordable housing, on workforce, and on transit, and to bring scale, whether it's with funding or these other programs. So I thank you so much for your time this evening. It's been a pleasure, and I want to thank our panelists for their time. Thank you very much.